Anyway, it's great to be in the house of God this morning. We're going to talk a little bit about that later on. But I thought I'd share with you first and foremost that I had what was probably the most amazing verse of the day pop up on one of my readings this morning. Matthew 20, normally verses of the day are fairly kind of encouraging and out there, aren't they? They're the ones that you just grab something by and love it. But this was Matthew 25, verse 6. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom, come out and meet him." Well, it's got to be one of the most random verses of the day that I've ever come across. But it is a timely reminder that the Lord is coming back again. It's in the middle of the parable of the virgins, the 10 virgins. The 5 were wise and had their oil in their lamps and they were ready and prepared, and the 5 were a bit daft and didn't have their lamps prepared. And then at midnight the bridegroom came, even though they didn't know when he was coming. So it is actually, although it seems a bit of a random verse, it's quite good that we need to be ready, because the bridegroom is coming at any time. At midnight the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom, come out and meet him," being ready for him. And I trust that we are ready for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ whenever that comes about.
You want to break in to dip your oil in my lamp.
Before then, we sing. And we're going to welcome the Holy Spirit into our midst this morning with this fantastic song. Beautiful.
Hands reach out and our hearts
God, let's do that. We didn't open in prayer at the outset. I'd like to leave it open for you to pray your own opening prayer. You can pray it out loud, you can pray it quietly. I don't mind, but we'll bring this service before the Lord, and we will declare that He is welcome here to move among us with holy fire as we lay aside our earthly desires. Praise His name. Praise His name. Praise His name. Praise God. Praise God. Let me bring you the reading from the scripture that we are going to be concentrating on for a little while this morning. This is Psalm 122. It's the beginning part of Psalm 122. I love the fact that it's a song of ascent. There's some interesting discussion about what that song of ascent means. There's several psalms that are written with that in mind. Basically, it's a lift up. It's a pick up. It's a walk up to the top of the mountain. And David was very much doing that when he wrote this psalm. I rejoiced with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing in your gates, Jerusalem. Jerusalem is built like a city that is closely compacted together. That is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord according to the statutes given to Israel. There stand the thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. I rejoice with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord today. Totally brilliant. We're going to look at that verse in a little while. We're going to concentrate on him. But before we do that, let's sing again. The awesomeness of God is in our mind here. I know these are old songs this week, but these are lovely songs because they speak of the magnificence of God in our lives. Come on, Father God, I wonder, that melts into our God is an awesome God. And that's where our praise and our worship is today. Our awesome God. We're going to listen to the Word of God, and then we're going to discuss the Word of God. But before we do either of those two things, I want to play you a song on video. So if you can take your seats, that would be lovely. Sorry, you'll find the term awesome appears in quite a lot of this message. And why not? This song is another elderly one, old song. You are awesome in this place. Let's just allow it to carry us into the presence of God even more than we already have. It's not a song that we've sung in the church here before, but it is a wonderful song. I'm going to play this to you. I love that song. It's beautiful. It's not in our worship songs playlist, but it may well end up there very soon. It will certainly be available for you. I'll put a link to it in the video. awesome in this place. There's a fantastic idea of what the house of God is and should be about. I have my upbringing in the faith was quite complicated. I started off in Sunday school at a church called All Saints Church in Hanworth, which was a 1950s built building. It's a magnificent building, a wonderful gold apse. It's absolutely beautiful. You can see it online if you look up All Saints Church Hanworth. It's still beautiful now. It's still a lovely church. For a modern church, it is beautiful. Then I ventured to follow my postman, would you believe, into a Methodist Sunday school. But that Sunday school took place in my old primary school. So that was a building that was familiar to me, but it was nothing like as ornate and grand as All Saints had been. And then I went off to a Pentecostal church in Hounslow, and that building was again an early 1960s built building, but it was nothing special. It was more or less just like a shed, really, built brick. But it was the place where I met God. Different architectures, different times, different places, different people, but one magnificent God in all of those places. I don't know about you, where you're upbringing has been in the faith, but you may recollect places where you've met with God especially. And King David was in that position. And I want to just bring this verse to you from Psalm 122. I rejoice with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing in your gates, O Jerusalem. Now, I've spoken about the house of God before. I'm not going to deny that. It's the thing that I come back to occasionally, because actually presence in the house of God has been a bit turned on its head over the last few years with the closures during the pandemic and such like. And we need to reevaluate where we are. Lots of businesses, lots of organisations. I was reading earlier today that pop groups touring the UK has diminished dramatically since COVID. They've never quite got back into their stride after the various lockdowns. In fact, there are half as many touring bands in the UK now that there were in the 1990s. Because show how far they are. Lots of pubs have closed because people haven't gone back into pubs after the pandemic. Those closures that we had have made a difference to a lot of organisations, and churches are one of them. And I'm glad in some ways, and I wouldn't want to throw off the benefits that we gained from those times in terms of online outreach and things like that. But I do want people to come back into the house of God, and I do want people to become familiar with the house of God again, because it's beneficial to them and to us and to everyone concerned. And no, it's not just about money in the collection pot. It's the whole spiritual atmosphere of church that matters in this environment. The house of the Lord has been central to both the old Jewish faith and Christianity since the temple was commissioned by God himself. The tabernacle, excuse me, was commissioned by God himself. As far as I can see, there was no dedicated house of God in Abraham's time. Under Abraham's covenant, it came with Moses' covenant. But Abraham did build altars. He built four of them in particular that we know of. One was at Mamre, where lots of saints were buried, I think. Then there was Mount Moriah, where he built an altar there regarding the Lamb of God. And then there was the altar at Bethel, which is another one that he was erected at the time. We're going to come to Bethel in just a few moments. And there's one that I think was an altar at the most prophetic place of all. Ai. That was always a favourite in youth group quizzes when I was a kid. A two-word answer was never found much in the Bible, but Ai provided it under many, many quizzes that I took place in. But of course, now we have Ai. We suffer from Ai. photographs and things that are written out for you, and the irritating way that things that you write on your phone are changed for you because AI knows better than you do. But AI was first of all a place in the scripture, and Abraham built an altar there. Brilliant. Absolutely wonderful stuff. But then there comes this special activity that happened at Bethel. It wasn't Abraham. It was his grandson who was involved here. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he was on a journey away from his familial house, off to find love.
Love.
When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? Mighty God. As we've just heard, this is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. He had seen that vision in his sleep of the stairway between earth and heaven, and angels ascending and descending in it. And in that moment, he knew that this was a unique place. This was a special place, because God had met him there. He said, surely the Lord is in this place. I wasn't aware of it. Not surprising, really. Only laid his head down on a stone to get a good night's kept. And that's exactly where God wanted him to be, for that dream to occur and for God to speak into his life and Jacob's future to be changed from there. But right there in that moment, we can see the conditions required for where someone somewhere was regarded as the house of God. God was discernibly present. The awesome power of God was felt there. Miracles took place. That vision took place. Wonderful, wasn't it? And at least for one moment in time, it was where God met with this person that he needed to be with. And it was a place where access to heaven, a gateway to heaven, was opened. And I absolutely love that as a definition of the church, that the presence of God should be perceivably here. We should be able to feel the presence of God. We should know the awesome power of God in the house of God. Beautifully too. And at least in the moments that we are in this building, in any church building, if it is a church indeed, we should be able to feel God's power, his awesomeness in this place. Now, I've got to tell you something. When the kids are bouncing around in here on the morning of Sunshine Corner, I don't feel the awesome power of God in this way. But when we meet together and we sing and we worship and we pray, we don't conjure up the power of God. He manifests himself to us, as indeed he did with Jacob in that place. And most importantly of all, the church needs to be a gateway for people accessing heaven. They can find God anywhere, but this place, churches anywhere, should be places where people are introduced to eternity and the power of God in that place. If I may say, God loves setting up Bethels, ad hoc or permanent, places where he meets his people. Maybe you've got a room or a place in your house or somewhere else that you go to pray and you feel the presence of God there. And why not? It's another Bethel. It's another place where God is choosing to meet you. The house of God, the house of the Lord that David rejoiced to go to, was before the first temple was erected. So that was the tabernacle that was there at Jerusalem for him to go to. It was a place where David was at home. He rejoiced with those who said, let's go to the house of God. It was no hardship for him. In fact, I'd go so far as to say in this modern parlance that it was his happy place. And I think we should make our happy place in the presence of God. In the Bethel that is Emmanuel Church, maybe. In the Bethel that is your bedside table where you meet God. I don't know. In the Bethel that is your place in the park where you sit and read the scriptures. I don't know. But that was David's happy place. And being in the presence of God, being in the house of God, being in our Bethel ought to be our happy place too. David rejoiced there. He absolutely knew that that was where he was going to meet God. The New Testament was slightly different. The church first met in the temple in Jerusalem, but the church did not make its home in the temple of Jerusalem. In fact, God had expressly told them that they were going to be his witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the rest of the world. They couldn't get back to the temple on a Sunday, Saturday, whatever, for worship. They had to create Bethels where they were, places where God met them, where they were. And so they met in people's homes. They met, as we know from Philippi, down by the riverside. They just met where the presence of God was, their own Bethels in those places. Very quickly, God shirked off the old law-related temple and gave them their own home in their own homes, their Bethels in their own homes. The term assembly or ecclesia, as it is, appears quite frequently in the New Testament. It is often translated church for us, but it never ever refers to a building. It always refers to the people of God. Jesus himself used it in Matthew 16, verse 18. I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my ecclesia. I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. He wasn't talking about a building. He was talking about the people. He was talking about the collective people of God who met to worship God. It's hard to say when or where the first church building was built. I've had a little bit of a look. According to the archaeological digs that I've been on, or reading Wikipedia, whichever you prefer, the first church never appeared before AD 30, more likely after AD 66, somewhere around that time. The Catholic Church favours the cenacle, the site of the Last Supper. I've got to tell you something, it doesn't matter. The only thing is, I would like to find the first person, and this is another conversation I'm going to have with somebody in heaven. I want to find the first person who said, "Here's a building." That'd be a great idea if we had one of those. Because that man lumbered us with gas bills, electricity bills, cleaning bills, furniture bills, putting kettles on, making the place warm. That man is responsible for the caretaking of all the buildings of churches that have come since. And I want to have a swift word with him about doing that. But there was no Corinth Cathedral. There was no Ephesus Abbey. What mattered was when the people met together that God did amazing things for them. I just read to you what happened when David went to the house of God. He was rejoicing in the house of God. And I've read to you what happened when Jacob found God at Bethel, that it was awesome. That's what the New Testament church experienced too. If you take a quick cursory glance at Acts chapter 2 and verses 43, you'll find that the New Testament church were in awe when they broke bread, when God did great things among them. The word awe is there. That place was awesome for them too. And you find in verse 46 of Acts 2 that the word says that they were glad and they had sincere hearts. You see, what applied to David and what applied to Jacob applied to the New Testament church as well. So it ought to apply to us, that when we come into the house of God, we feel the awesome presence of God. And we come in with glad and sincere hearts. Too many times, I think, people come into church buildings, and this is why I want to have a word with that fella, because sometimes coming into a church building fills us with grumpy hearts that we need to avoid. It's a bit chilly in here this morning, isn't it? Look at the dust on that window ledge. We quickly turn our attention to what the building is. We do it the other way as well. We go to various wonderful church buildings and we think, that's magnificent, it's wonderful. We mercifully here in Eastleigh live very close to Winchester, which has a beautiful cathedral, magnificent cathedral in its grounds. And you haven't got to go far the other way to Romsey to see the glories of the abbey that is there. But God is not impressed by the architecture of Winchester Cathedral. Although building it was undoubtedly an act of worship. Neither is he impressed by the magnificence of the abbey at Romsey. Although again it's undoubtedly a beautiful building and act of worship in its own right. But the presence of God is no more there than it is here. The presence of God in Winchester Cathedral is no more or less than it would be if there is a church in Winchester that meets in a school or in homes. Because the essence of the house of God is that we go there with joy to meet God. We go there with a glad heart to meet God. And we expect to be in the awesome presence of God. If that was good enough for Jacob and good enough for David and good enough for the early church, that's good enough for me. And if there is an extra layer of dust on the window ledges, the Lord bless that dust. I don't know. The presence of God is more important than the aesthetics of it. I've got to tell you something, and you will have seen this because you know the building, or if you've seen photographs of it on our invitations and things, that the edifice that is Emmanuel Church, originally built as the Desborough Mission Hall in 1905, is not a glorious piece of architecture. I'll tell you what it does do. It blends in beautifully with the terrace houses that it's actually attached to. But it's no glorious cathedral. It doesn't need to be. But the presence of God is in this place. And I want to dwell in the house of God forever. It's always about the presence of God in the places that we meet him. Genesis 28:17, Jacob at Bethel, how awesome is this place. 2 Chronicles 5:14, Solomon's temple is being opened. The priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the temple of God. So there you've got it. Not only did the Bible invent AI, but it also invented cloud storage. And the blessing of God came down from that cloud. And in Matthew 17, verse 6, at the transfiguration, they heard the voice of God from the cloud, saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And when the disciples heard the voice of God, they fell face down to the ground there in that place. And of course, we have Pentecost. I don't need to remind you about when the power of God fell in that place. So what should church be like is a question I'd like you to ponder. And also, what would the ingredients of church be? We're going to discuss that now. Video will be edited out. And then we will come and sing one more time at the end. Praise God. Well, welcome back to the service and back to our closing song, which will be "Not oil, give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning," as people thought I was going to go with the original reading that I gave you from Matthew. But we are into "Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining, shine, Jesus, shine."
Yeah.
So our closing prayer will be, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this church with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood each member of this church with grace and mercy. Send forth your word and let there be light. Amen.